Hello students, today we'll be taking unit 1 of some basic concepts part number 2, which will involve information about units and measurements. Whenever we do any measurement in chemistry, a physical quantity which is measured has always two parts, a numerical value and a unit. For example, if I measure length of a pencil, I can say the length is 10 centimeter. The number 10 is the numerical value, centimeter is the unit. Suppose we write any physical quantity without a unit, it will not carry any meaning. For example, when I say pencil length is 10, what is the unit of it? Is it meter, centimeter, kilometer? We do not know. That is why whenever we write measurements in chemistry, it must have a number as well as a unit associated with it. Unit is a standard of reference chosen to measure any physical quantity. Now, over the years, scientists have decided from experience which standard of reference to choose. Accordingly, a fundamental unit is that which is independent unit, and it will not depend on any other quantity. From last 400 to 500 years, fundamental units were given in different systems. The oldest system is FPS system, also known as British system. The fundamental units initially decided were length, mass and time. So accordingly, FPS system was foot for length, pound for mass and second for time. After several years, CGS system was developed, which has centimeter for length, gram for mass and second for time. Last around 100 years, MKS system has been in use, where M stands for length meter, K for kilogram for mass and S for second for time. Last 500 years, you can see the only unit which is unchanged is time, which is second. In 1961, Committee of Scientists decided to have basic system of units. Accordingly, they developed what we today call as SI unit system. Earlier, there were only three physical quantities which were basic: length, mass and time. Now they have increased it with four more quantities. So the total seven quantities of SI units are length, mass, time, temperature, electric current, luminous intensity and amount of substance. The units which were decided for them were taken basically from MKS system and later on extended. So length has a unit meter, mass has a unit kilogram, time once again second, temperature was taken as Kelvin, current was taken ampere, luminous intensity was assigned as candela, and amount of substance was taken as mole. A basic difference you can see when you write symbol for the unit. Wherever there is a scientist name involved, the symbol is capital, like Kelvin is capital K, ampere is capital A. All other units are written in small units, small letters. Besides these basic units, we have something known as derived units. These are the units which are derived from the fundamental units. What were the fundamental units? We saw it previously, the seven units. So from those seven units, other units are derived. This is a sample table of few derived units. For example, area is meter square. How does it come? Because area is measured as length into breadth. Both are measured as meter. So it is going to be meter into meter, meter square. So some of the derived units you can see here are area, volume, density, force, pressure, energy, potential difference. You need to remember this list by heart for your exams. when we write SI units or measurements, there are chances where some of the physical quantities are either too large or too small. To change the order of the magnitude of these units, prefixes are used. Let us see an example. Suppose we have a number, mass is measured as 5000 gram. This can be split into 5 into 1000 gram. And for the number 1000, we write the term kilo. So the unit becomes 5 kilogram. That's how we can say 5000 gram is same as 5 kilogram. Now at this point, I want to clarify something. Most of the students from school level are known with units like kilo, milli and so on. We always imagine these as alphabets, kilo, milli. Now here onwards, always you should try to change in your mind the term kilo as powers of 10. For example, according to this table, you can see whenever we say a term deci, it indicates 10 raised to minus 1. Centi is 10 raised to minus 2. Milli, 10 raised to minus 3. Micro, 10 raised to minus 6. Nano, 10 raised to minus 9. Pico, 10 raised to minus 12. A similar in the fourth column, you can see prefixes for positive powers of 10. Observe two things over here. Deci, centi and milli. The difference in the powers are of only 10 units. 10 raised to minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Or deca is 10 raised to 1, hecto is 2, kilo is 3. Milli or kilo onwards, the difference is of powers of 10 raised to 3. So it's now milli to micro, 3 units jump. Micro to nano, 3 units jump. Nano to pico, 3 units jump. Even for mega, giga and tera, it happens the same way. I have not shown here the complete table which goes up to 10 raised to minus 24 or there 10 raised to 24. But there also, after pico and tera, there will be a difference of 10 raised to power of 3 only. As a student of science, you must by heart this table of all the prefixes of SI system. Let us see now how to convert units from one unit to another, larger to smaller. First, I am taking a very simple example of milliliter to liter conversion. Here we know milli from the earlier table as 10 raised to minus 3. So I translate the letter milli m as 10 raised to minus 3. I got my conversion milliliter to liter. This was quite easy. Let us see another one. Gram to milligram. Now gram is kind of a base unit. I have to convert it to milli. Now recollect, what was milli? Milli was 10 raised to minus 3. So I need to introduce 10 raised to minus 3 in this number. If I directly write that, I will change the value of the given number. So I will introduce 10 raised to minus 3 as well as multiply by 10 raised to plus 3. You can see the number power has not changed at all. So now, taking 10 raised to minus 3 as milli, I can now write the answer as 612000 milligram. You can see the highlighted number and alphabet. 10 raised to minus 3 we have taken as milligram, and other numbers we have segregated. Take another conversion like this. 500 megagram to kilogram. First, you must recollect what was mega. Mega is 10 raised to 6. Now we want kilo. Kilo is 10 raised to plus 3. We need not multiply anything. From 10 raised to 6, we can extract 10 raised to 3 separately. So we can say 10 raised to 6 is now split into 10 raised to 3 and 10 raised to 3. Out of that, the yellow part 10 raised to 3 is kilo. So I can say 500. Further 30 kilogram. I hope the conversion things are clear to you. We have to follow some conventions while writing SI units. First convention is the symbols of the units are never expressed in plural form. For example, if a number is 15 centimeter, we must not write 15 centimeters. While reading, most of the time people say 15 centimeters, 12 kilometers. While writing scientific way, we should not pluralize any unit. If a unit is named after a person, then it is not written with a capital letter. For example, unit of force is Newton, so it should not be written as capital N Newton. Unit of current is ampere, so should be written with a small a. But if a unit symbol is named with a person and it's a one letter unit, then it has to be capital. So unit of force is capital N, not small n. Unit of current will be capital A, not small a. This is something very interesting, and usually up to school level we do not follow this. If derived unit have anything written as denominator, denominators are not allowed in modern SI units. We have to write them with a negative index value as numerator only. Most common unit we use in science is meter per second for velocity. And look at the way it is written, meter s raised to minus 1. Let us see the convergence of different quantities. Now this is a kind of table we will need to remember and by heart. For mass, the unit is kilogram, and the conversion of kilogram, 1 kilogram is 1000 gram. For volume, the SI unit is meter cube, but the popular units are centimeter cube and decimeter cube. The conversions are written, 1 cm cube is equal to 10 raised to minus 6 meter cube. 1 decimeter cube is 10 raised to 3 centimeter cube, or 10 raised to minus 3 meter cube. Remember, the unit centimeter cube is same as milliliter. Decimeter cube is same as liter. For temperature, the SI unit is Kelvin, but the other units are degree Celsius and degree Fahrenheit. As we know, atmospheric temperature is measured in degree Celsius. Body temperature, human body temperature, is measured as Fahrenheit. This equation which you can see is a common equation joining all the three type of units: degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit, as well as Kelvin. One thing I want to clarify here, Celsius and Fahrenheit are written with a term degree. Kelvin is never written as degree Kelvin. The units of pressure are too many. SI unit is Newton per meter square, which is written as Pascal, PA. But more than that, the popular units are ATM, millimeter, centimeter, tor, and so on. Units of energy, SI unit is joule, but other units are erg, liter atmosphere, calorie, and so on. We will talk about pressure and energy units in other topics, but not required right now today. Whenever we used to write the numbers of measurements in chemistry, there is now a standardized way called scientific notation. Because many times the answers of your problems or measurements are too long or too small. So as a standardized thing, they are written with a format n into 10 raised to n. This is called scientific notation. Let us see an example. Avogadro's number is quite a huge number to read. So they make a short format in scientific notation and write 6.022 into 10 raised to 23. Remember one rule here. While writing scientific notation, the decimal point must come after first digit only. So this number cannot be written as 60.22, or it cannot be written as 0.6022, and so on. It has to be 6.022 into 10 raised to 23. We now come to some statistical concepts called accuracy and precision. This is another aspect when we do measurements in physics as well as chemistry. Accuracy is defined as closeness to the true value of result. Understand it with an example. Suppose we are doing measurement of a mass, and mass of a substance is, let us say, 2 gram. So suppose our measurement, what we do, is 1.99 gram. That means our reading is close to the true reading. So we say our reading is accurate. On the other hand, precision indicates closeness of various measurements. So suppose we do a particular measurement, but we repeat the readings 3 to 4 times. Then is every reading coming out to be similar, or they are differing too much? That is called precision. Imagine the same example which I was discussing. True value of a mass is, say, 2 gram. And one person is taking two readings here. Suppose person A does measurement number 1 as 1.95 and 1.93. So his average is 1.940. Let us comment on this. What about person's A's measurement? We can see the readings are precise. Once again, what was precise? Closeness of his measurement. 1.95 is similar nearby to 1.93. But his average 1.940 is quite away from 2 gram. So it's not accurate. Compare it with person B. His readings are 1.94 and 2.05. Average is 1.995. What can we say about precision? His both the readings are far away. So the readings are neither precise. Once again, they are not near the true value. So we say nor accurate also. Now see the best readings, person C. First reading is he's coming as 2.01, 1.99. Readings are quite nearby and average comes out to be exactly 2. So the readings are accurate as well as precise. To explain this concept, we repeat one more example. So here I am repeating the definition, nothing I have changed. Accuracy is closeness to the true value. Precision is closeness of various measurements. This is explained with a simple dart game. For example, first left hand side corner diagram you see. And on this dart game, all our hitting are nowhere near the bullseye. So it has low accuracy as well as low precision. See the second diagram in the first row. You can see a lot of darts have gone to one similar point. So precision is very high, but all of them are away from the bullseye, so low accuracy. Third diagram, where you can see almost 3 to 4 darts have gone near bullseye, so it's high accuracy, but none of them are near to each other, low precision. And the last one seems to be the best one, where all the darts have aimed at bullseye, high accuracy, high precision. We come to another concept of significant figures, which we need to remember for our answers when we solve multiple choice questions. These are the digits in a number, which include certain digits and one last doubtful digit. There are some rules we need to know for writing significant figures. Rule number one, all non-zero digits are significant. For example, in a figure 57, the significant numbers are 5 and 7, so it's 2. 64.5, significant digits are 6, 4 and 5. But when you compare 0.4361, the significant figures are 4, 3, 6 and 1. And the 0 before decimal point is non-significant. Rule number 2. Zeros between two non-zero digits are significant. So in a digit 8005, significant figures are 8, 0, 0 as well as 5. Rule number 3. Zeros to the left of the first non-zero digit are non-significant. So in 0.53, significant figures are only 5 and 3. 0.0724, significant figures are only 7, 2 and 4. The two zeros are non-significant. We continue with the rules. Rule number 4. If a number ends with one or more zeros and they are to the right of the decimal point, zeros are to be counted. So 4.0 has significant figures 4 as well as 0. 2.500 has significant figures 2, 5, 0 and 0. Third example is quite interesting. 0.040 has only significant figures 4 and 0. Rule number 5. If a number is written in scientific notation, the powers of 10 are not to be considered. So for example, 1.07 will have significant figures 1, 0 and 7. 1.070 will have significant figures 1, 0, 7 and 0. Rule number 6. If a number ends with one or more zeros, then those zeros are not counted. For example, 43700, the significant figures are only 4, 3 and 7. Here I want to add, which is not shown on the slide here. Suppose the number given is 3200 meter. A unit is associated with it. Then the significant figure becomes 3200. But here, since only 3200 is given without any unit, the significant figures are only 3 and 2. Rule number 7. If the number is written as an integral number and associated with some counting, then significant figures are considered infinite. For example, 12 pencils, 24 erasers, 13 notebooks. This is considered as infinite significant figures. Another aspect which we need is rounding off concept. If the results given are too long, then we have to use certain rules for rounding off. Let us see them. First rule is, suppose the number given is 2.736 and we have to round off till only 3 significant figures. So we have to delete the last digit 6. If this digit is more than 5, then 1 is added in the previous digit. So the rounded off figure is 2.74. If the number to be rounded off is 2.734 and 4 is to be ignored, deleted, that number is less than 5. So we have to keep the previous digits as it is, 2.73. Now comes the dilemma. When we have the number to be deleted as 5 itself, not more than 5, not less than 5, it's 5 itself, then the rule is slightly different. We have to see the previous digit before 5. If it is an even number, we keep the digit as it is. If it is an odd number, we have to increase it by 1. So 12.65 is rounded off to 12.6. If 12.35, it's rounded off to 12.4. Using the concept of significant figures, rounding off, we come to the last part, how to apply this in chemistry calculation. Suppose we are doing addition and subtraction. Remember the rule, they are slightly confusing. These addition and subtraction cannot have more digits to the right of decimal point than either of the original numbers. Let me explain it with an example. Suppose it is 3.423 plus 5.3 plus 9.34. You get the answer as total answer as 18.063. But we have to round off and report the result. So how do we do it? Check the number, significant numbers in every digit to be added. So the accepted result would be 18.1. What is the rule we used here? We check after decimal point how many digits are present in every number. In the first number, there are three digits after decimal point. There is one digit after decimal point in the second one, and two digits after decimal point in the third one. So which is the lowest one? It's one digit after decimal point. So I have to keep only one digit after decimal point. So 18.063, I have to delete 3 and 6. So I'm deleting 6. Since the number is greater than 5, I add 1 and write a result as 18.1. So in this kind of solving, you must know the rules for significant figures, the rules for rounding off everything together. Take another example. 24.3671 minus 9.01. We get a big answer, 15.3471. Now, how many digits we should keep after decimal point? Only two digits. That's why the answer will be 15.35. 71 has been deleted, one is added after 4. These were the rules for addition and subtraction. Now, what are the rules for multiplication and division? They are slightly different. The rule is, result should be reported with the same number of significant digits as possessed by least precise term. Let me explain with an example. If it is 5.728 into 3.9, you get some big answer. Here, the answer reported is only 22 because numbers which we multiplied had minimum significant digits as only 2, 3, 9. So here also reported result is 22. Suppose here we have answer of division as 4383. So the significant digit accordingly will be 0.44. We have seen one rule of addition subtraction, another rule of multiplication division. Now comes the combination of multiple operations. Here let us see, instead of rule, an example itself. We have an actual result of multiplications and division like this, and final answer reported is 0.74. So significant figure will be taken as the least precise number involved. This is completing our unit number 1 of the first topic.